All right, let's bring Kevin Martin in. I think we're going to put him on the couch, I guess, if that's where he wants to sit, which is the first time we've actually ever used this couch. Good morning, my man. How are you? I'm doing
good.
That's
awesome.
We've never had anyone sit in this couch yet, yeah. So we just kind of put this in the studio recently.
I like it. It's cozy.
Yeah, it's almost, I feel very intimate with Kevin now because... almost like we're going to have gay sex or something. We're just so close. We're just
we're pretty close.
Sitting here chatting.
Yeah. Good morning, guys.
Good morning. How are you, man?
Good. I just woke up. We just got here from Lexington. So.
You know what's funny is that when I think of Candlebox, I think you just picture
sleep?
You. No, you picture you with long hair from like.
Good old days.
I was talking earlier that album came out when I was in high school, that first Candlebox record.
Right, right.
Everyone had that record.
Yep.
And I remember going on like camping trips, and we'd leave the car turned on so we could play that Candlebox record. And I mean, that must have been, how old were you at the time that came out?
When it came out, I was I just turned 24.
So you were still a pretty young guy.
Yeah. We started the band when I was 20.
So what is that like to put out a record, and it's the first record that you guys put out, and literally everyone goes out and buys that? I mean, that must have changed your life overnight.
Yeah, pretty drastic. I mean, it was amazing. You know, I think for us, we weren't really prepared for it. We knew it was, Seattle was obviously a hotbed and everything was going on great there. But I think when we put the record out, we just kind of expected it to do something. And then the next record would grow and we would grow and grow and grow. And I think that when it actually happened... we were not prepared. I mean, going out on tour with Metallica in the summer of 94, you know, was a real shocker for us as well. And at that point, our record was selling like 100,000 copies a week. So it was crazy, man. Those were the good old days.
Did you take criticism? Because I can remember some people at the time would...
Most people at the time.
No, at the time, there were people who go, oh, these guys are just, they're fake. It's fake grunge, and it's fake this, it's fake that. People, there was some criticism of Candlebox back in the day.
Yeah, I think there was, unfortunately, it was misdirected. You know, Seattle was, had we come out in, 1990... we would probably not have taken that. But I think the biggest misconception about Candlebox was that we moved to Seattle and started the band. And the problem was is that we're all 5 and 6 years younger than the guys in Pearl Jam and Alice in Chains and whatnot. So when they were doing their deal in 89, 88, we just got out of high school.
Right.
So I graduated in 87. My bass player graduated in 89 or 88 or 89. So... it was just a problem, but we took a lot of heat, and it was cool. We still sold records and bought houses and stuff, so, I mean, I guess it doesn't really matter as long as your life's working.
Is that where you grew up in Seattle, or did you move there later, or what did you do?
I moved there from Texas when I was 14.
Okay.
But the rest of the guys...
So it wasn't like a calculated thing, like, hey, these guys moved to Seattle to cash in on the grunge scene.
Yeah, no. Well, I was living in Texas, and I knew that Seattle was going to be awesome in 84. So
sure, right, yeah.
I told my parents, we need to move to Seattle because it's going to be really cool, because Texas sucks.
Well, I'll get a record deal. I'll get a record deal out of the whole thing. Come on, Mom. Let's go. You guys just quit your jobs. Let's move to Seattle. So that's where you met all the guys from Candlebox, was up in Seattle.
Yeah, I went to school with the bass player Barty. Scott crashed my 16th birthday party with a guy I don't like, and Pete's the only guy in the band that none of us knew, and he was introduced to us by our producer Kelly. So it's a really kind of just a circle of friends sort of thing.
So you start this, when did you start this when you were in high school? You started Candlebox?
I started right when I was just turning 20, I started the band with Scott.
Okay.
And then Barty joined when I was 21.
And how did you guys actually end up getting a record deal? Because that in itself, the way that they make it seem is that record label executives just descended on Seattle at the time and just started signing anyone that they could get their hands on because grunge was exploding.
Yeah, I mean, that's what a lot of the people that have written the books, Everyone Loves Our Town and whatnot, they like you to believe that that's how it was, but it wasn't really like that. Most of the A&R guys were seeing the bands in Seattle either playing in San Francisco or they would see them play in Los Angeles. They did come to the city, and we got signed or invited down to Los Angeles by somebody who saw us at a BMI showcase. And that was, I think it was June of 92. So we started the band in 90, and in 92 we get some attention. So And then Maverick came to the show we played in Los Angeles because they heard we're going to be there and said, hey, you guys, we'd love to have the band on the label. So that's how it happened for us. But
that almost sounds too easy.
Well, it was.
It sounds easy. I don't know if it was
relatively
easy.
It was relatively easy, but the whole process of actually getting a show in Seattle at that time was next to impossible because our bass player wasn't 21, so the bars wouldn't let you come in and play. So when we actually did get the chance, Barty had just turned 21, and then this guy said, "Hey, come play this BMI showcase." They made us go on first at 7 o'clock. The place was packed, and this one A&R person said, "Come down to LA and play for Fred Davis at EMI SBK." And said, okay. So we flew down, and then the first song we started, Pete broke a string in the set, and we thought, well, this is it.
That's good. That's bad news.
Bad news. And so it took him, you know, you can't change a guitar string in 5 seconds.
Right.
So that took a little while. So we're standing there, and then he changed the string, and we kicked back into it and sold the show. And we had several people that were just like, wow, you guys are amazing. But Guy Osiri from Maverick said, come over to the label and let's talk.
So then you put out this record. It sells, I don't know, millions of copies, I'm guessing. I don't know how many.
Yeah.
4 or 5 million. I don't know what
somewhere
it was
around there, yeah.
And tell me what happens when you just explode like that. I mean, what, girls just start throwing themselves at you?
Well, the funny thing about Candlebox is nobody knew what we looked like. Even though you had the album cover and we were on MTV, we would go out during our opening band sets and watch them play, and people didn't know what we looked like.
They didn't even know that it was you.
So it was pretty cool, man. You know, tuck the hair up under the hat and go out and have fun. So,
yeah.
I mean, you know, it was a great life, and it was exciting. The only problem when you get that kind of success, you if you don't have somebody around you telling you how to control things and where to guide yourself financially and whatnot, you can get into a lot of trouble. We were just fortunate enough that when we did kind of have the drug and alcohol problems in the band sort of thing, that we got it under control as soon as we could. But the problem at that point was that our label was imploding. So when Candlebox went away in 2000, it was mainly just to get off Maverick Records because we knew that the company was going to implode. It was going to move over to Warner Brothers, and we didn't want that kind of a relationship. We wanted out of the deal. So it worked, but then we were locked into a contract where we couldn't do anything as Candlebox for 5 years.
Right.
That's why we went away till 2005.
So. Kevin Martin from Candlebox is here with us. So you guys, I mean, I'm assuming that you go out, you're selling millions of records. People are just coming up to you. Hey, let's party. You're drink. I mean, did it just all of a sudden overnight? Are you just drinking every night, doing drugs every night? I mean, what? I mean,
well,
to me, that
were,
seems like you're young, yeah. You're 24, and you're thrust into a spotlight that few people can even imagine.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
And that's probably tough to deal with, and you're just going with it. You're like, hey, we're having a good time. This will last forever. Woo!
Yeah, well, we were smart enough to know that wouldn't happen. I think not in our case. You know, we weren't really big partiers. I quit doing drugs when I was in high school. So, I mean, I was kind of past that stage. For me, you know, having a Jack Daniels or, you know, a Don Julio tequila every night is just kind of the norm now. Back then, I wouldn't get, you know, blitzed. We had shows to do, and we took ourselves pretty serious with our shows, and we put on great live shows. I mean, there was a drug and alcohol problem in the band that kind of snuck its way in, but, you know, you sit down with the guys and say, look, you know, you need to get this under control, and we've got a job to do, and don't take this for granted. It's not going to last forever.
So one of the guys in the band starts doing a bunch of drugs, and that's affecting your performance.
Two of the guys, you know, Pete and Barty got pretty screwed up with it. But, you know, I think that for us, we were able to, as friends, sit down and say, you got to knock this off. You know,
yeah.
It's not a good lifestyle for you. And it's not a good lifestyle for the band. And we got things to do. Take it serious and quit screwing around.
Now, I'm wondering what kind of a deal that they make these bands. So you get on a record label. A lot of bands, they go, this is just, we just need to get signed to a record label. This will be great. And then you go out and you sell 4 million records. Did you guys make any dough off of that, or did you get raped financially? Because every band has a story that they we should have gotten a lot more money than we really did.
That's true. I mean, every band does get screwed. That's why when they get a chance to go off on their own, Pearl Jam starting another label. I mean, you're only earning 17 points. Percentage, what that means of the wholesale cost of a record. When you do a record with a producer, that producer is going to take 3 or 4 of those points. So now you're down to 12 or 13 points on a record. And that means percentage of the wholesale cost of a record, which is $7.99. So if you're only getting 13% of that, you're getting 87 cents, 90 cents a record.
And then you have to split it up with the four guys.
20% to your manager.
Taxes, take out.
Taxes, take out that. So if you sell 4 million records, you may make $4 million.
Yeah.
Where you make your money is touring, and that's why people still tour, and that's why bands like Candlebox still tour. I mean, this is what pays our rent, is being here and talking to you guys and playing a show tonight, and hopefully it sells out, and everybody has fun and talks about it. Next time we come back, we go to a little bit bigger place, you know? I mean, that's what it's all about.
Candlebox will be a house of blues tonight at 8 o'clock. So did you... So you did pretty well financially then off of that? I mean, you're still, some people just still go out and tour because they like it. Some people do it because they have to. Would you have enough money saved after? It just seems like when you sell 4 million records, you should have a bunch of money in the bank and all that touring and stuff. But
well, you make your investments. You know, I did very well, and then I got divorced. And
that will do it to you, won't it?
I was living in California. Yeah, so it's half of everything goes away.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, you can make yourself a lot of money, and you can live if you're very smart. Our bass player, who's no longer with us, Barty, he is an attorney in Seattle. His main investment, when he got the first advance from the label, he bought 4 shares of Berkshire Hathaway.
Oh.
Which was $11,000 a share.
Warren Buffett's company,
now it's $300,000 a share.
Yeah.
So, I mean, and Barty actually has, I think, 10 shares of that stock. So,
wow.
Barty made really, really smart investments. The rest of us, we, you know, we have our IRAs. We have.
You bought a Ferrari or something, right?
No,
what'd
no.
you do? What's the thing you blew some of that money on? Did you go out and make any really extravagant?
I traveled a lot. I bought a Porsche, but I bought it used.
Traveling's fun. You can't blame people for traveling. You know, if you have a bunch of money, going out and traveling, you kind of learn about other people. You meet other people. You see places. It's not like some of these guys that just blow. I bought a gold plated lawnmower.
Yeah. That happens too. Now, Scott, our drummer, you know, did the same thing. Scott went out and he traveled the world for 2 years.
Wow.
Just took a backpack and went, and you just do what you can to get away from kind of the headspace of the business. And then when everything went down with Maverick Records, man, it really screwed us up. You know, it locked us out of some stuff, and we lost a massive amount of momentum as a band, and we're trying to rebuild that now.
So you guys put out the first record, it sells a bunch of copies. The second record doesn't sell nearly as many. Is that because the record wasn't as good, or what was the cause of that?
I would say that there's several issues with that. You know, we didn't make the follow-up to Far Behind, and I think a lot of people expected that. But the funny,
if you had to do it all over again, would you go, let's just change a couple chords and put out a song that sounds just like it?
No. I think if I had to do it all over again, what we would do is we'd spend more time on the record and really focus, because there's great songs on that record. I think the problem is it's a very raw album. It's very rock and roll. It's very punk rock in the sense that it doesn't... adhere to any norm. It's a record that we wanted to make, and frankly Maverick Records allowed us to make that record. We didn't have real A&R direction at the time, and our manager didn't step in either, so really the only thing I would focus on that record is spending a little more time on the mix, spending more time on the songs, and making sure that the record grooves a lot more than it does. And the nice thing about Candlebox is, like with our new album, we're very groove oriented, and there's a real passion and movement behind what we do musically, that feels really good. And Lucy is really, really raw. It's a really aggressive record. And I think that has a lot to do with the fact that the guys were staying up doing blow all night, and you know, I'd come into the studio, nobody'd be there, and I'd be like, what the hell happened here?
What kind of toll does it take, just because people have, anyone in entertainment, and I'm assuming bands as well,
sure,
there's a pride factor involved in something, you know? And if you put out something, you sell 4 million copies, and the next one doesn't sell nearly as many, is there like a personal pride thing that you're like, you know, son of a bitch, does it really bother you? Or what goes through your head at that point?
Well, I think if we'd had the expectations that we were going to sell 4 million of the first record, then yeah. For us, it wasn't. I think it was a letdown. I think we knew we had let ourselves down, and we'd let the record down, not the label or the fans. I think that for us it was, this is the record we want to make. And, you know, it's kind of like that Get Him to the Greek scene where he's like, I'm proud of every one of those units. You know, how many records did Chocolate Daddy sell? 12,000 copies. You know what I'm saying? Like, we're proud of that record. And Eventually, it's going to sell a million. I think it's actually at 999,000 copies. Literally, it's very close.
Go out right now and buy it, though, at a million copies.
Get us that, you know, that platinum plaque. No, I mean,
I get half the platinum plaque for pushing them over the top today.
I'll send it to you. But, you know, I mean, no, I think that the pride factor is that we sold 4 million records. And that was our wildest dreams. And,
yeah.
And so... we're not disappointed in Lucy. We're not disappointed in Happy Pills. I think there are a lot of factors that let those records down. And quite honestly, it has a lot to do with Maverick, the label that we were on. You know, after we blew up, then they signed Alanis, and Alanis went gangbusters.
Alanis Morissette. Yeah.
They really lost focus, not of us and the Deftones and Alanis. They lost focus of themselves. They went from this, you know, great little office in Hollywood where you really only needed 8 people because you only had 3 bands, to buying 3 floors of a building down in Beverly Hills and moving in 20 staff members each floor. There was no need for that. And in that process of spending that kind of money and focusing on themselves, they lost focus of the label, which, you know, now we all know that Maverick Records is gone. And those bands have all left and gone on to, you know, stay at Warner Brothers or whatnot. So that really was the demise of Maverick Records, was really the downfall of Candlebox, Alanis, and the Deftones.
Kevin Martin from Candlebox is here with us. He'll be over at the House of Blues tonight at 8 o'clock. For tickets, call 216-523-2583. Their website, CandleboxRocks.com. Well, how come you had to put the rocks? Does someone else own CandleboxRocks.com?
Yeah, Maverick didn't secure the Candlebox.com.
Oh, so, man. And I'll bet you probably went to the guy who owns it, and he's like, give me
Korea.
$10 million.
Yeah, somebody in Korea.
That sucks, man.
Yeah.
You, so during this time, you said that you got divorced. When did you get married?
I got divorced in 99. I got married in 97.
So, all right. So it was a little bit after all of...
We'd been together the whole time, too.
Oh, you did?
So we probably should have never gotten married. That was.
I've always said that. Don't get me... If things are working, don't get married. It screws things up. I mean, and there are still guys who get married, and I don't know what the... Every guy that you know... You have friends, Dieter, right? What do they tell you about getting married?
Don't get married.
Right.
You're getting a divorce now after a couple of years.
Right, yeah. Right. You didn't get married again, did you?
I did, yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Kevin's not as smart as I thought he was.
Well, actually, I am. She's 11 years younger than me.
Yeah.
She's Australian.
And probably a hot piece of ass, right?
Hot as hell. And we have a beautiful 4-year-old.
Sounds so. Like, well, all right, if you can do that, if you can get a hot piece of ass Australian who's 11 years younger than you, go ahead,
then,
get married.
Yeah. Good idea. Yeah.
If you're me, don't get married.
Yeah.
So you were together with this first wife of yours all throughout the whole Candlebox explosion and all that from the time. Was that difficult? Was it good to have her? Or did you go, I want to be out banging a bunch of chicks. I got in a band for a reason, to get some trim. Now I'm shackled to this chick.
Yeah. It was a strange relationship. We had a very strange relationship. She was cool at first. And as a relationship, the problem was that she was in the business. So she knew what musicians did. So that made it very difficult for me to be on the road. And when cell phones came around, she started checking my messages.
Blowing up your phone and all that. Oh, yeah,
checking my messages and be like, what are you checking my messages for?
So like you'd be out on the road and some hot chick would come backstage and you'd give her your number and then your girlfriend would hear the voicemail message of the girl left you later. And that's bad news, isn't it?
It was tough. And you know, I thought by getting married to her was going to fix things, and it just got worse. And then, you know, not to mention, which I didn't find out at first when we first started dating, she was a Scientologist. So it was,
She's trying to recruit you into the cult, huh?
She did, actually.
Oh, you didn't actually become a Scientologist,
no.
Did you? Oh, okay.
No. Right. I'm Catholic. I already have enough, you know, crazy guilt in my life to deal with space aliens.
So, like, during this period of time,
mm-hmm.
You probably, it sounds like, to me, I don't know you at all, but it sounds like you probably actually probably kind of liked this girl, but at the time, you're sitting there, you're a 24, 25-year-old guy. You literally have thousands of girls who want to bang you, millions of girls who want to bang you. Mm. You have to take advantage of that. At the time, you were conflicted, I'm guessing.
I was conflicted, but at the same time, you know, I had 2 older brothers and an older sister. And I'd had, you know, by the time the band was signed, I'd had several sexual partners. So the thing that for me was, you know, I always thought to myself, if she's coming on to me, or she's coming on my bus, how many other buses has she been on?
Yeah, right, right.
And I don't want to, you know, I'm not a sloppy seconds guy at all, and I'm not really, you know, I just, that's not my thing. So it made it easier for me to put that thought in my mind, even, no matter how hot they were. And let me tell you something, some of the hottest women in this town, in Cleveland.
Really?
Oh, my God, dude. I we used to come here.
It must only come out for you.
I'd be like, I cannot wait to go to Cleveland. I'm serious, man. You know.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. And actually, I'm still friends with one of them. Very, very good friends with her. And nothing ever happened, but she's quite a piece.
Maybe you'll see her tonight. Maybe.
I probably will.
Perhaps.
Take her to the baseball game tomorrow.
So did you, so you didn't bang as many chicks as people may think during those years?
I didn't
so.
Bang any chicks.
No. Really?
No.
You never cheated on this girlfriend?
No, I didn't say that.
Okay. So you had sex with some of these women, but not as many as...
I did not have sexual
relations
with them. You know, I mean...
She was in the business, this girl, this first wife of yours? Yeah. What do you mean she was in the business? Record label?
She worked for the label. She also was Madonna's production manager. So that's how I met her, was at the label.
Oh, boy. So that could kind of throws a monkey wrench into the whole thing,
yeah.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
That makes life difficult. But now you're happy. You're happily married now.
Very happy. Yeah, yeah.
Where are you living these days?
Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Yeah. I hate it.
Why are you living there if you hate
it? My wife loves it. She's Australian. She loves the heat. She loves the beach. That's the way it is.
What does she do? Does she have a gig, or she just follow you around, off your dough, or what does she do?
No. I live off hers, man. She's very talented. She's a clothing designer, and she does handbags, very expensive Italian handbags and stuff.
These chicks will buy that kind of crap, too, those handbags. Like, you ever seen this stuff, Dieter? They'll make a handbag, and it's like $2,000 or something, and girls go out and buy that stuff.
Yeah, that's what she does.
I couldn't tell you if it was $2,000 or $2. So, you know, these women.
Guys can't tell.
Oh, my God, no. So that's what she does. She designs this kind of stuff.
Yeah, she's actually in Bazaar this month with that Penelope Cruz issue. One of her dresses is in there. So.
Really?
Yeah. So she's very, very talented.
So she makes some pretty good dough off of that.
She does.
That
pays the rent. I don't have to work.
Wow, it sounds like you've got a pretty good gig going on. What's over here, Kevin. Yeah, this guy knows how to live his life. So, you know, I also read that Kevin Martin, I don't know how accurate this is, that... that the remaining members of Live, and you guys hooked up and formed a band.
Yeah,
and
Gracious View.
I don't know if they. Now we've had Ed Kowalczyk here in the studio a few times. The lead singer of Live. We've talked to him about the, you know, you get differing stories or whatever. Sounds like these guys really didn't get along too well. The members of Live and him, correct?
Well, towards the end. You know, from what I know of the story, and you know, I really try to stay out of it because I'm friends with Ed and I'm friends with the guys and I have a band with them. I think that at some point Ed being the main songwriter just got fed up with the guys not working the way he works. And he works very, very hard. I know him, and he's a busy human being, and those guys tend to like to sit back and enjoy their lives and, you know, smoke a little weed and, you know, kind of hang out and do the thing. And I think Ed really had a new vision for the band and the guys didn't agree with it. And he started making some kind of crazy demands and they said, you know what, that's not what we're going to do. And so he left. And that's unfortunate because great band. And to this day, I keep telling the guys, work it out with them.
Get back together.
Work it out. It's a great band.
Yeah. So Ed doesn't hate you for forming a band with all of his former members or anything?
He may. I don't know. I mean, I don't know why. I don't know why he would.
I didn't know if there was.
Ed, I didn't break you up. No, you know. It's not like, you know, it's not like we were out cheating on one another with, you know, with our bands, with our mistress or anything like that. Yeah. It just, they called me and said, Ed's going to do a solo project. What are you doing right now? I said, I got a little time between Candlebox. So we made that record in 3 months and toured on it and had a blast. Went to Europe, came back, and we have 16 songs now in the can. Going to do another record sometime next year.
I know there was some lawsuit going on with that too. I forget what it was. I don't know. I think someone was suing.
They're suing him.
Yeah, they're suing him for some reason. I forget why or whatever. But I don't know. I guess it's that crazy kind of stuff goes around. You ever been sued?
I have. Yeah.
What'd they sue you over?
I got sued over a car crash once. I got a date like.
If you get in a car crash and someone knows that you have a little bit of fame and a little bit of money.
Well, she's an ex-girlfriend.
Oh, how does that work?
That's what I tried to figure out because we had the crash like 4 years before I got signed. And then she filed some claim that like she had migraines or something because of the accident. And I was in Europe on tour, came back, tried to renew my license. And they're like, your license has been suspended. What are you talking about?
And it was 4 years prior to this?
4 years prior.
All of a sudden, yeah, when you get signed, ooh, my neck hurts.
My headache.
You have to be careful.
She was mad. She was very angry with me. She did not like me.
Why is that? Because you broke up with her? Or what'd you do? Or did you cheat on her?
I broke up with her. She was crazy. And she kidnapped me, actually, from a show one time. She asked me to get in a car and talk to her, and she had taken the spindle off the door lock.
Yeah.
So I got in the car. She started talking to me, and I was like, you know what, Sarah? This is why we broke up, because you're absolutely nuts. And I tried to get out of the car, and I couldn't get out, and she took off speeding and kidnapped me to her house. My buddy called the cops. It's like, my buddy's been kidnapped.
Oh, my God.
It's crazy. And then she sued me 4 years later. It's nuts, yeah.
Sounds like you have a thing for crazy chicks, it sounds like, almost. They're better in bed, aren't they? Oh, the crazier the girl is, the better in bed they are. It's just the rest outside of the bedroom, you can't put up with them.
Right.
Because they're crazy.
Nuts.
Yeah. Sounds like you've had a pretty exciting life. No one's ever sued you over like band stuff, business stuff. You never threw anything out into the audience and hit someone in the head or anything like that. You're lucky if you haven't had a million lawsuits.
We've had those kinds of approaches, but we were such nice guys, honestly, that they've been like, just come to the hospital and say hi, or come to this and say hello, and you know, nothing will happen. Which we were kind of like, well, did we even do that? But you know, we never knew what happened. We just, like, there was something I think it happened in Cincinnati at Bogart's. And
I've been to that place.
We first went through there, and somebody got hurt at the show, claimed that it was because of us, because I guess they were stage diving or something, mm-hmm. and said that we had incited the riot or whatever they call it, and just come to the hospital and say hi, and we'll drop the charges. Like, what?
All right.
I don't even remember. So we got to the hospital. I was like, this is a girl. Apparently she had been hurt by somebody that had stage dive that, you know, fell on her friend, then her friend fell on her, and she fell over and twisted her ankle or some crap. It was just like, really?
But she got to meet you, though, at least, right?
She got to meet us. She was hot, and she was crazy.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you're the crazy.
I've had a lot of crazies now that I think about it.
I had a girl kidnap me one time, man. I swear on my life. You know that story, Dieter.
Which one?
The one where I was out after the Browns game. And I ended up in the hotel.
Oh, yeah.
With the big girl.
Yeah, this fat chick. Yeah, I forgot that part. You woke up.
So listen to this,
Kevin.
That's
convenient kidnapping.
It is very.
Well, so I'm at the, we go to this tailgate. We tailgate at the Browns game, you know, which is big here. We go do a lot of drinking, and afterwards go to a bar, and there were these hot girls there. Dom, were you with me, Dom? Yeah, you were with me.
Oh, yeah, they were. Yeah, you started. That was a good start to the day, buddy. Real good start.
I just start, and then remember I was making out with that hot chick? I'm making out with this hot girl?
I would say you started working around 8 to 9s, and then slowly throughout the day, each hour I'd say you went down a point or two.
No, that's not true. At the bar, remember in the booth, I'm making out with a hot chick. You remember that?
I do remember that,
yes.
Thank you. Okay, well, you were down to maybe 7.5 at that point.
So then I go, I need to go to the bathroom, and I'm loaded, loaded. Sure. I go, I need to go to the bathroom. Honest to God, the next thing I remember is waking up in a hotel room next to a strange girl the next day. And I swear, I really believe she kidnapped me. And I'm not saying that in a joking
manner. Or did you black out?
Dosed to you.
I think I came out of the bathroom loaded, and she was just like, come with me. And I'm like, I want to get back to those hot girls. Mm-hmm. Where'd they go? And she... No, I end up in a hotel room. How I end up in a hotel room and not back at my house, I don't know.
Because hot girls will only make out with you at the bar. They won't take you home.
Yeah.
Well, it's
the big girls.
Most of them don't even do that with me. Yeah, right. Nothing wrong with a big girl here and there, though, right?
Love more to love.
You ever bang a fat chick?
Yep.
You have?
Good times.
Even you, man. I mean, come
even
on.
Even me.
Really?
I like the dark side.
Have you ever... You ever been drunk at home or something, and you're thinking to yourself, God, I need to get laid, and you're like, I know this fat chick I can call. She'll just come over right now.
Yeah, no.
You never do that?
No.
No, all right.
No, I'm married. My wife probably would have a
problem. All right, well, pre-marriage or whatever.
So no.
Sex life is good, even being married and
fantastic,
everything?
Fantastic.
It is. Yeah, it doesn't...
My wife's crazy.
I thought it would go down, you know, being married, or after kids.
She's 11 years younger, man.
A lot of people complain once they have kids that it just absolutely kills the sex life.
No, my wife is, she's definitely a
Those Australian girls are hot.
I'm trying to think of how to say it because my wife's fantastic.
She'll do anything in the bedroom, basically.
Pretty much. Yeah. Well, she's very, my wife's very aggressive and she's very sexual. So it's.
She'll throw you down.
Yeah. And, you know, Jasper goes down for a nap. 10 minutes later, I swear he's not asleep, but she's on me. You know? I mean, he's still awake. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
You know,
that's great.
Yeah, she's crazy. She's great. I mean, she's
now, is she crazy outside of this or just crazy in the bedroom?
She's a little both.
Yeah,
it's a little both. I mean, we have several moments, you know, a year where I'm kind of like, whoa, just calm down a little bit. You know, you're getting a little crazy.
You guys fight and stuff or no?
We don't fight. We have good arguments, though. Yeah. And Australians are good arguers.
Yeah. She have that hot little sexy accent.
Yeah, mate.
God, that's so hot.
It is pretty hot. Well, now she's been in America so long, she's kind of losing. I'm like, you need to keep practicing that accent.
You don't want her to sound like a valley girl from California or
it's
something.
It's great. She goes back to Australia like 2-3 times a year to see her family, and then she does her clothing line out of Australia, so she comes back and she's full on again, so it's pretty great.
Wow.
Exactly.
She's playing with your didgeridoo, huh?
She plays with my didgeridoo all the time.
Oh, yeah. Kevin Martin from Candlebox is here with us. They're going to be over at the House of Blues tonight at 8 o'clock. I'm going to give you the number to call for tickets right now, 216-523-2583. That's 216-523-2583. Their website, CandleboxRocks.com, because some Korean guy got Candlebox.com, so don't go there. Don't give him any traffic. Go to CandleboxRocks.com. You guys have a record out now?
We got a new record out, yeah.
What's it called?
It's called Love Stories and Other Musings.
Love Stories and Other Musings. Mm-hmm. I actually went to your website a while ago.
Yep.
And it played a song from this record. Yep. I have to be honest with you. You sort of think, all right, I haven't heard much from Candlebox in a few years. I'll bet whatever they put out now sucks. No, I'm just being honest. But it was playing a song in the background, and it was actually good. I was like, this is pretty good.
Yeah. Surprising, 20 years later, we still got it, right?
So hard to get on radio and all that, though.
I mean, It is, yeah. I mean, it's a different world, you know, and thank you for having me in. I appreciate it. You know, it's a different world now, you know.
Charlie, can you pull up his new song there? What is this?
No, it's Cover Me.
Oh, yeah. Get this off. Put something new up. We've heard
CD.
This.
All right.
Cover Me's played a million times. We've all heard this.
Okay.
What's the name of it? What's a new song?
Believing It or Sweet Summertime.
Believing It or Sweet Summertime. Find one of those, Charlie. Let's give this guy. Yeah. Let's give this guy some.
Look how mad I look in that picture.
Oh, say, yeah, you pissed off. You go, I'm pissed because I cut my hair.
There you go.
All right, I'm gonna let this play us out for a little bit, Kevin. I appreciate you. Play it.
Play it, man.
What's going on, Charlie?
Spotify, it's not doing it.
This whole internet thing, I don't know if this is going to catch on, playing stuff off Spotify.
This crazy inner world.
Yeah, I don't know. Let's go back to CDs, eight tracks. They just never stopped. Kevin, thank you for coming in.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate
Have fun
it.
At the show tonight.
Thank you.
You'll see that hot girl from
sure
Cleveland
am.
Over there
sure
tonight.
Am.
Don't cheat on your wife with her. Just remember that Australian accent.
Yeah,
or does she let you? She's not that
no
crazy,
way,
does she?
No way.
She doesn't say you can do whatever you want on the road or anything like that?
Nope.
She ever let you have threesomes or anything?
Nope.
No, she's not into that. She's not that crazy.
She's not
huh?
that crazy.
Thank you. Thank you for coming in, Kevin. I'm going to take a quick break. Go see Candlebox at the House of Blues tonight, 8 o'clock, 216-523-2583 for tickets. We'll be right back on Rover's Morning Glory. Hang on. Even if something-